The definition of a martyr is someone who is killed for their religious or other beliefs, in which case the British politician Enoch Powell is most definitely a martyr. Of course, he wasn't killed literally, having died of Parkinson's in 1998, aged 85, but he is killed figuratively all the time by those who've turned him into a convenient scapegoat for the sins of modern Britain. In life, Powell challenged government orthodoxy on everything from the economy to immigration. In death, Powell continues to serve as a rhetorical bogeyman, invoked like the name of Voldemort to shut down important debates. Sadly, this posthumous reputation shows no sign of relinquishing its hold. Outside a handful of admirers, Powell's name is all but unmentionable. He is associated with and accused of having been everything from a racist to a fascist. No other recent or living politician elicits this level of spite and hatred. A test of this, let's call it the Enoch test, is to ask whether anyone confessing to admire a particular politician would be more or less ostracized if that politician were Enoch Powell. Take Nigel Farage, for instance, the architect of Brexit and one of the very few politicians to tackle the subject of immigration head-on. There's no doubt Mr. Farage is immensely unpopular in metropolitan centres like London, Reading and Oxford, but he is popular enough elsewhere to remain within the confines of the Overton window, the range of politically acceptable discourse. Powell, on the other hand, has been thoroughly defenestrated. The truth is that Powell was no worse than Farage and on many points a great deal better. Outside of politics, Farage is a chain-smoking, heavy-drinking, habitual fly-fisherman with various side hustles in the world of finance. Politically, his influence has been extraordinary. Privately, he may be remarkable, but he is ordinary, and there's a difference. Powell was extraordinary. A veteran of the Second World War, a classical scholar, an author, a linguist, a philologist, a biblical translator, and a poet. Indeed, he was once a student of A.E. Houseman. And whether one likes it or not, his influence on politics has been profound, to the extent that Margaret Thatcher's economic policies owe more to Powell than, as is commonly assumed, to the Austrian school of Friedrich Hayek and Milton Friedman. His influence, however, is muted, to borrow a phrase from Percy Bysshe Shelley. Powell is an unacknowledged legislator, stalking the byways of discourse and the halls of power like a ghost. So what happened to him? How did the man once tipped for number 10 fall from grace? Why is he hated today, and why does he deserve, as I believe he does, a hero's resurrection? It's not my purpose here to provide a biography of the man. For this, Wikipedia more than suffices, and should anyone wish to learn more, I recommend the biography by Simon Heffer, Like the Roman. As to the first question, therefore, how did he fall from grace? One need only discuss the speech for which he is best remembered. The speech's very name, Rivers of Blood, a phrase absent from the speech itself, conjures the image of a furious, foam-flecked statesman doing his best to summon the forces of hatred. It was given to a meeting of the Conservative Political Centre in Birmingham in 1968. It criticised mass immigration and the proposed race relations bill. Hitherto, Powell had certainly been a thorn in the side of Ted Heath's government, but was a long way from persona non grata. The speech changed everything. The offending passage was a quotation from Virgil's Aeneid. "As I look ahead," said Powell, "I am filled with much foreboding. Like the Roman, I seem to see the river Tiber foaming with much blood." Powell was referring to what he thought would be the likely consequences of mass immigration into Britain. Far from what people tend to assume about him nowadays, however, he did not think these consequences, these rivers of blood, desirable. In fact, he feared them. His rhetoric was born of concern for the immigrant, not contempt. It's worth stopping here to note, or rather to concede, that Powell's inflammatory language was ill-advised. Racial tensions in 1968 were undoubtedly high, and it did Powell no favours using the language essentially of mass slaughter. It was irresponsible, and he was sacked from the government the very next day. It's become part of the mythology of the speech that it made immigration harder to talk about rationally, but given the weight of officialdom that condemned the speech and its author, it seems more likely to me that the bien pensant had already made up its mind on the issue. Curiously, a poll taken after the speech reported that 74% of Britons agreed with Powell, and 30 years later, in 1998, 64% of the audience of a television show about the speech voted that Powell was not a racist. It's also worth conceding that Powell was at least in one respect wrong. The British people have proven themselves to be much more tolerant than he suspected. He predicted much blood as a consequence of 50,000 immigrants per year. By June 2021, Britain's foreign-born population stood at 9.6 million, and that's only the people we know about. And every day, boatfuls of immigrants, some refugees, some most assuredly not, arrive on the Kentish coast, fleeing that well-known war-torn nation of France. And yet there have been no uprisings on the part of the British, no rivers of blood, no mass reprisals or ethnic cleansings. On the other hand, Powell was fundamentally right. As he said, quote, "For reasons which they could not comprehend, and in pursuance of a decision by default, on which they were never consulted, they found themselves made strangers in their own country. They found their wives unable to obtain hospital beds and childbirth, their children unable to obtain school places, their homes and neighbourhoods changed beyond recognition, their plans and prospects for the future defeated. At work, they found that employers hesitated to apply to the immigrant worker the standards of discipline and competence required of the native-born worker. They began to hear, as time went by, more and more voices which told them that they were now the unwanted. And this is exactly what has come to pass. For it is true that the British people were never consulted about mass immigration or its consequences. It is true that in many parts of the country the British people feel like strangers. It is true that school places, hospital beds, and houses are much harder to obtain as a result of mass immigration. And it is true that many employers now openly favour what's called diversity, but really means race quotas. As for the much blood, Powell predicted, this has come in large part not from the British, but from the immigrants. One of the central tenets of multiculturalism is that Britain can and should serve as a harmonious salad bowl of cultures, ethnicities, and religions. But of course, this doesn't even work as a culinary metaphor. A salad with too many ingredients is inedible. A brief look at the cultural, ethnic, and religious landscape in modern Britain reveals a plethora of problems unknown to the country before the era of mass immigration. Pakistani rape gangs in the north and the Midlands, Sharia patrols in major cities, female genital mutilation, the burqa, witchcraft, mass machete brawls, frequent stabbings, Islamic terrorism, high levels of illiteracy, organized Albanian crime, indifference or contempt for British history and customs. With the exception, a very long time ago, of witchcraft and more recently of illiteracy, I know of no incidents of any of these other phenomena in Britain before, say, 1970. These are imported problems, alien to British social life and customs. I said that the British were tolerant. It might be more accurate to say that we are long-suffering, prey to a host of problems none of us chose, but which we endure because deep down most of us recoil at the thought of laying the blame at immigrants in themselves. In my experience, the vast majority of Brits are kind and welcoming to foreigners, an unfashionable but useful and accurate word. Also in my experience, we feel, but do not know how to articulate, or are perhaps scared of articulating, the sense that we are somehow beleaguered, choiceless, at the mercy of forces beyond our control. We see our communities changing rapidly around us and can turn to no one, no party, no politician with the power to arrest the process. Enoch Powell tried to arrest the process before it was really underway, and for that he was punished. Accusations of racism, or racialism as it was then known, came thick and fast. Defending himself in the Birmingham Post a month after the speech, he said, "What I would take racialist to mean is a person who believes in the inherent inferiority of one race of mankind to another, and who acts and speaks in that belief. So the answer to the question of whether I am a racialist is no, unless perhaps it is to be a racialist in reverse. I regard many of the peoples in India as being superior in many respects, intellectually, for example, and in other respects, to Europeans." This alone should be sufficient to bury the accusation that Powell was a racist. But most people who make that accusation clearly haven't taken the trouble to learn anything about his life, about, for instance, his decision to quit his membership of the prestigious Bicolour Club in British India when it refused entry to his friend, General K.M. Karyapa, India's first army chief. The proprietor said that the club only allowed white people, to which Enoch replied, "Then take my baggage out of this club. I'm going to stay with my friend, General Karyapa." Powell's concern was always cultural, not racial. He saw clearly that the colour of one's skin was neither here nor there, and that what really mattered was one's cultural assumptions and practices. Why, then, is he so hated today? Why, as a politician whose predictions have come largely true, and who is demonstrably opposed to racialism, become the arch-racist of political mythology? My own theory is that he is hated precisely because he was right. As politicians, think tanks, and journalists slowly concede that multiculturalism hasn't been an unmitigated success, they resent being reminded that they were wrong, and always were wrong. And Enoch Powell stands as an immovable totem on the road, or rather the river, to this self-discovery. No one ever enjoyed apologizing. I suspect he's also hated because he was just too damn good. He was a good politician, and with the exception of Margaret Thatcher and Tony Benn, one of the last great orators in British politics. He spoke in full, rhythmic, and resounding sentences, a far cry from the stuttered platitudes and clichés of a David Cameron, a Jeremy Corbyn, or a Rishi Sunak. Mediocrity resents superiority. A third reason he's hated is simple ignorance. As I've already said, most of Powell's critics don't know the first thing about him. Having been turned into a scapegoat and a pariah and a bogeyman, he remains easier for the incurious to attack than to examine. Depressingly, most of these attacks haven't changed at all in the 50 or so years since his death. Debating the author, actor, and director Jonathan Miller on The Dick Cavett Show in 1971, Powell is subjected to the same accusations and misinterpretations to which he is subjected today, the difference being that, whereas Miller appeared the intelligent and compassionate one then, he appears in retrospect the idiot.
Say that. Well, you think then that it would be noticed, but that it would not be merely be tolerated, but would be taken as a desirable or acceptable development.
No, I didn't say that either.
Well, that is what you have to say. You have to say.
But even though many have come round to Powell's view, albeit sheepishly and privately, it's remarkable how little the debate around immigration has changed. Critics of mass immigration are still routinely accused of racism. What about the Huguenots, they're asked, as though 50,000 Huguenots arriving in England over the course of decades was comparable to the influx of millions in the same length of time. It's simple common sense that many people, often from vastly dissimilar countries, would have a detrimental effect on Britain's social cohesion. But common sense is the rarest of virtues. Ideas have consequences. It's high time the champions of mass immigration face the consequences of their own ideas, which have progressed insidiously from no more than 50,000 a year to open advocacy of open borders, such as the imperceptible movement of the Overton window, by the sly and stealthy salami-slicing tactics of fanatical left-wingers and liberals, we have arrived at peak absurdity, the absurdity of equating national borders with national socialism. "For ye have the poor with you always," said Christ. To which the political philosopher might add, "and the poor shall be always the first to suffer." This has certainly been true of mass immigration, from the consequences of which the wealthy have always at their disposal a mansion or a gated community to hide in. For in nothing are the rich richer than the choices available to them. Good schools and tutors, safe houses and safe areas. They are shielded from the outcomes of their own beliefs and favoured policies, but they're quite happy to use less fortunate areas and more benighted people as petri dishes and guinea pigs in their own experimentation. Witness the Yorkshire village of Linton-on-Ouse, population 700, but soon to be 2,200 when 1,500 asylum seekers are dumped there for processing. The case of Linton-on-Ouse is a microcosm of what has happened to the country at large. Here is a people with an identity and a history, and suddenly, without warning, they are subjected to an experiment from on high. Many of them have already said they intend to welcome the arrivals. That's to the good and a testament to our tolerance. But it would also be boneheaded stupidity to deny that the village of Linton-on-Ouse, whatever one's views on immigration, is about to undergo a radical change of appearance, habit, and atmosphere. What will happen to Linton-on-Ouse is this. As the experiment takes its toll, and crime rates rise, and the stock of social trust diminishes, many residents will speak out. But they will not be heard, except by a handful of media outlets. The official, the sanctioned narrative will be that the experiment was a success. Original residents with money will move elsewhere. Those without money will have no choice but to stay. In 10 or 20 years, only a smattering of English people will live there, and lo and behold, the narrative shall emerge that Linton-on-Ouse was never an English village, that immigration had always been a part of its history, and is also the cause of its success. Come to Linton-on-Ouse, it's vibrant and exciting, and offers a range of cuisines. Those, of course, that do complain about the rapid transformation of their home will be accused of hating people with a different colour of skin. And it will never, ever be conceded that it was not the colour of skin to which the people of Linton-on-Ouse objected, but culture. In short, the desire to live in one's own culture, among familiar people and familiar mores and expectations, is a desire best kept to oneself. Enoch Powell saw all of this coming, and for that, if for nothing else, he deserves rehabilitation.